Hi, welcome to Heart Talk, a six-part relationship podcast where we invite you to have real conversations about real relationship realities. If you've been watching our previous podcasts, you'll know that we have been looking at things like key practices for building a healthy relationship. We've been looking at the different types of intimacy in a relationship. We also had a wonderful session looking at how to navigate mental health challenges as a couple. And then the last one was cultivating trust in a relationship. So, and if you haven't seen any of them or listened to any of them, we encourage you to go and to our podcast and listen to them. So once again, we are your hosts, Jose
and Cheryl.
Today's topic is a little bit different to the previous ones. So all the other topics we've been looking at are or have been in the context of marriage relationships. So today we're going to look at how to develop a relationship in the dating process. So this kind of takes us back 36 years. All right. Can you believe it? 36 years ago we were dating. Just by way of introduction, there's so many definitions of dating in today's culture. And I think it's become more challenging over the years. And the way even our parents and grandparents, and those of you that are listening and watching, your parents and grandparents, the way they dated is a lot different and maybe even unappealing to you. And the question is, who taught you or who is teaching you how to date? And who is modeling a healthy relationship for you? And probably in most instances, no one. Okay. So many people are getting together without any roadmap as far as the dating process goes. Or the only roadmap they have are all the rom-coms and the media and the podcasts. And some of them are good, but a lot of it is just not good at all. And I think if you don't have a roadmap that you can follow, the chances are that you will not get anywhere in an effective and efficient way in terms of your dating. So not many people are taught how to date. And most important, one of the aspects about dating is in the dating process, how to build trust. And trust even within the dating process is very important to the relationship. And let me say, building trust is not the absence of mistakes, but it's learning even in the mistakes how to clean up your mess, if there is a mess made. And for your relationship to go well, you need to be intentional and you need to be proactive. A lot of young people we've seen want the relationships just to happen organically. And they want things just to happen, you know, because they're in love. But if you have an organic relationship, there's a lot of insecurity and there's a lot of uncertainty. And you won't really know what's going to happen next. And when things do happen, they kind of throw you. So today we're going to look at a number of steps. I think it's about 14 steps. And you can actually almost picture it like a ladder, okay? Each step, and you need to take these steps in the dating process. And each step is helping you to build intimacy, but it's also helping you to build trust. And I think the key thing, one of the key things we want you to take away in this session is you never want your intimacy level to go above your trust level. And if it does, what's happened then is you've created insecurity. So let's have a look at these steps. So let's start with the first one. The first step is asking the question, do I know me? So Cheryl, do you want to just share some thoughts around, you know, what is that about? Do I know me?
Okay, I think very interestingly is that as a society, we feel that if we don't have a significant other, a male or female in our life, that we are not significant. So in order for us to be whole and in order for us to be significant, young people and even older folk, they feel that they are only complete if they have another relationship, which is not important, which is not true.
That's not true at all.
And then I think the other one is, can I stay consistent with my convictions?
I think it's that's also very important. So whatever convictions you have about anything in life, don't compromise those convictions for the sake of you want somebody in your life, whether it's a man or a woman, and you're willing to give up those convictions. Just stay true to your convictions. And if there's nobody for you at this particular time, be okay with being single. I think that's, today, as you said, today's environment is just so much pressure. And unfortunately, even in the church context, there's a lot of pressure. We've seen it.
Also in the church context.
Yeah, I think sometimes the church is, it's almost like, until you're married, you're not fully a man or not fully a woman, or you're not really fulfilling God's purposes, which is, we want to break that. That is not true. You are as significant single as you are if you are in a relationship.
And then the other big thing is, don't be scared to be rejected. I've spoken to so many young people, and they are so fearful of loving or older folk because they are scared of being rejected. And I think that's the process of life.
Yes.
We're going to be rejected. In order to love, we're going to be hurt, and we're going to be rejected. So learning how to deal with the rejection in a positive way of actually saying, well, I've learned something in this relationship. When I get into the next one, it actually builds resilience within me to be able to be stronger for the next relationship.
Yeah. So that is, in a nutshell, know yourself, know who you are.
And then maybe the next question to ask is, are they safe?
Yes. So ask yourself that this person that you are now starting this dating process, because that's what we're looking at, are they safe? So you want to start a relationship with someone that has needs and acknowledges that they have needs, and expresses what their needs are, but also has boundaries. Because if you don't have needs and you don't have boundaries, you won't feel taken care of or loved. Okay, it's like we always say, you can't read other people's minds. In the dating process, you've got to tell each other your needs. Okay, and I think sometimes what happens in dating processes or people going in that process is they kind of feel it's honorable to not need anything. It's like, I'm not going to tell you what I need. I don't want to come across as needy. I don't want to come across as I have these, deep longings within me, So we don't express it to each other. And that's a lie.
Yeah.
It's not having needs is not true, and it's not an honorable thing. Yeah.
I think maybe also from the way we grew up, if we expressed our needs, people don't need to know where we're struggling, where we're suffering. So it's almost like a pride thing of not expressing your needs.
Okay. The next step that you need to ask, a question you also need to ask, is, can we have fun together? I'm going to talk about that one.
Yeah. I think that is very, very important. Looking at maybe the first question is, can I be me? In a relationship, am I able to show my true self?
Yes.
The good and the bad in me. And I think with couples, when they are in the courting scene, they try to portray someone that they're not because they're scared that if they don't show their best self, they don't put their best self forward, they're not going to be liked. So that is a very healthy part of a relationship. If you can be you and the other person can be themselves in the relationship. And then another one is, do I genuinely like the other person? Are there qualities about that person that I really like? in their character, in the way they carry themselves, in the things that they do.
Mm.
Do we like those things?
Mm. And even when they do show their weaknesses and things, do I still like them and accept them? Mm. Or am I like scared now and I'm going to run away? Mm. And rather, I think in the dating process is get to see those things. Mm. Then you enter into a more committed marriage and everything, and then suddenly all this stuff that you, the other person was hiding, or even that you're hiding, suddenly comes up. Yeah.
And then you don't know what to do with it.
Yeah. Now what do we do with it?
Okay. And then the next step is, do our core values line up? Very important one.
Yeah. So obviously it's important that you, each of you, know your own, what are your values in life and what are your priorities, and that you tell each other what my core values are. So, I mean, things like, you know, I value respect, or I value integrity, I value honesty, I value responsibility, I value self-control, all those key things, characters about a person, that so that the person knows, okay, this is what they value, and if I have weaknesses in these areas, I've got to work at something here. But the thing is, lots of people, what happens in dating processes is lots of people get physical, okay? And obviously there's different levels of physical in a dating relationship, but they kind of jump to the highest level before they've even answered these questions, before they even know that what this person's values are. And then what happens is they become so physically intertwined and connected that when they start seeing that this person doesn't have the same values that they have, is they will start, they start justifying, about the fact that, no, you know, we can stay in this relationship even though they don't have these values that I have. So
I think maybe when they jump into the physical side of things immediately, it lowers the bar for having to do anything, because I've already got the prize. Yeah. So I don't have to work towards intimacy intellectually, because I've already experienced the physical side of these things, and it's very sad.
Yeah, that's very true. You know, we've seen couples pre-marriage, you know, that already jump to the extreme, which is physical sexual activity, you know, and they're still dating. My strong belief is that what that does is, from a man's perspective, I know we're digressing a little bit, but from a man's perspective, a man is a strong motivation in a man is the desire for sexual activity. You know, that is, it's there. So what happens is, now they've, as you said, they've got the first prize, you know, they've got what they want, and there's no need to change. There's no need, because I've got it. And then if suddenly the female starts putting some requirement on them for, no, if you want that, this is what I want in the relationship. They say, but why? You know, you gave it, right? And as you said, for the woman, it's like you've made the bar so low. You know, you haven't required anything of your partner. And I think it works in that male-female dynamic, you know, because women are very much motivated by an emotional connection, more percentage-wise than men are. But they'd be willing to sacrifice that, you know.
Yeah, it is. We're willing to sell ourselves short just to actually be accepted and to feel that we belong, regardless of the price.
Yeah. Okay, the next step is, and the question is God in the God spot?
Okay, so you need to ask yourself the question, is God the ultimate source of your identity? Is God the one that gives you the direction in life? Is God the one that you run to for your protection, for your comfort, for unconditional love, for healing, and for mercy? Because if we don't run to God, we are going to put expectations on the other person
yep.
that they cannot fulfill and that they will not be able to meet. And it's you are being unrealistic with the other person.
Yeah,
you want to add something
to yeah, that? Yeah, no, that is so true. What happens is if you're looking for those things in a person mm-hmm. as the ultimate source and they don't deliver,
mm-hmm.
as you said, then you become disappointed mm-hmm. and frustrated. Mm-hmm. And it can also, and let's say you do get a level of that from your partner,
mm-hmm.
it can create a codependency
mm-hmm.
because now you're looking for that person to give you that unconditional mm-hmm. love consistently,
yeah.
to give you that hope consistently, mm-hmm. to give you that comfort consistently, mm-hmm. And you don't want that codependency.
Mm-hmm.
You want to, each of you must individually be able to run to the ultimate perfect source, which is
yeah.
God, you know.
Yeah.
That's, you know, when, and I know you see it in the movies, and but, you know, when people, when you hear this, you know, I can't live without you. I need you, you know. That's such a red flag, you know. If you can't live without this person, that's a red flag about where you are getting your source mm-hmm. of those things. And at best, your partner can only be a reflection of God
mm-hmm.
and a reflection of Jesus
mm-hmm.
And represent them him in some way, but they can't be the ultimate mm-hmm. source. Yeah, so that's very true.
And then maybe the next question to you, Jose, is do we have needs and do we have boundaries? Because I think you've said in the earlier that we all do have needs and we need to express those needs
mm-hmm.
and we need to put those boundaries into place in order for us to be safe. Yeah, in order for us to let our partners know
yeah.
what we need.
Yeah. But the next one, Cheryl, is, and I know this is like one you love when we do counseling, is you need to ask yourselves, do we communicate well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm. Yeah, interestingly, because when we see couples, we actually ask them, well, the big thing is we can't communicate. And the reality is we do communicate.
We always communicate.
Whether we keep quiet or not, that is communicating with each other. It's actually saying, I'm letting you in or I'm not letting you in. So the goal is never to get into an argument where you cannot navigate that argument in a healthy way.
Mm.
Because even if you're in an argument, you need to know that there is intimacy and there is trust in that relationship.
Mm.
So you can disagree. But you've got to have that behind you, knowing that I am respected and that I can trust you. People, I think when they find that they disagree, they get very scared.
Mm.
But it's the disagreements in life that actually create a stronger.
Yeah.
And I think if you look at us, it's the tough times that have actually caused us to grow more than the good times were good. But those were ones that were actually more remembered in our lives. And then I think if we do disagree, it sounds very cliche, but there's always got to be a speaker and there's got to be a listener.
Mm.
Because some folk feel, well, I've communicated very well. Yeah, you have, because you've spoken all the time
all
and
the
you
talking.
Haven't really given your partner the ability to listen.
Yeah.
So that comes to your communication styles. Often we've learned communication from our parents, as you said, which are
yeah.
not good communication styles. And I think because they've never learned how to communicate or to ask for what they want to do, they've basically kept quiet about it.
Mm.
And so we've learned from them. And
So I think it's very important if in the dating process you are struggling with communicating, then you know, look, find some resources
mm-hmm.
where that can help you identify what is your communication
mm-hmm.
style, what you know, and you might very well have to unlearn
mm-hmm.
a lot of your communication style that you picked up from your own family of origin and so on. and learn then how to communicate in a healthy and effective way. And there's, without going into specific tools, there's a lots of tools that one can learn on how to actively listen, how to communicate when you have a disagreement and when there is potential for conflict, how you can navigate all that.
Yeah, this is one that I think you love, is how to ask for what you need. And sometimes we have emotions that rise within us like anger. And instead of saying, oh, you make me so angry, what we need to get into a way of speaking of saying, well, I feel angry when you do this. And what that does is it actually diffuses the situation.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't make one the victim and one the good person.
And the other one the persecutor.
Yeah. It actually makes you take responsibility on both sides for your part in the argument.
Yes.
And then what it does is when you actually master the ability to communicate with each other, you lower the anxiety levels.
And
you create a safe place where you can actually communicate.
And you can learn how to solve problems. It's, as you said, it's when we meet with most couples that are struggling in their now post-marriage relationship, communication's always one that comes up. And it's because you'll find they've never learned any good ways of communicating.
Yeah.
And we just go to our defaults, you know.